Hello, friends, and welcome to Flosstube and Variety Show number 47. Today is June 10th, 2022. I'm Emily Williams in Chapel Hill, North Carolina, and thanks so much for joining me today. This is Flosstube, which means it's about cross-stitch, mostly, and it's also a variety show, which means it's about something else. So we'll have to see what that turns out to be today. Anyway, let's get going on cross-stitch, shall we? I will show you Flea Market Flowers. I will not take it out of the hoop, but this is a pattern by Lori Holt. I've been working up in this area. I'm almost done. It's really tantalizing. So I think last time I can't remember. Anyway, I'm pretty sure this blue flower was not as far along as it is. Very tantalizing to just blast on through and finish it. And maybe I will, maybe I will. The next thing I'll show you is, this is In Full Glory. This is a blackbird design. It looks huge here. It's really only gonna be about 5 inches by 6 inches, something like that. This is in the book called Sweet Land of Liberty. And remember that this was the one I was debating about, and I finally chose this one, and I did start it. This is my little start up in the corner. This is Nantucket Brew. I don't know, the tag when I bought this fabric didn't say who the manufacturer is, but those of you who know all about this know, will know what it is. It's sort of a gray color, I would say. And I'm using mostly the DMC floss that's in the chart, that it's charted for over dyes, which I don't have. So that's, but I enjoyed that. So, oh, let me just say another word or two. So I'll show this while I talk. I have never before worked on linen. I have worked on a 22 count hardanger fabric. And this is 40 count linen. I'm using one strand of floss, by the way. I've never worked with one strand of floss either. Linen is harder, but it's a little harder to see the holes. But because I'm going one strand of floss over two linen threads, so one over two, I think is the lingo, I don't feel like my stitching is gonna get lost underneath the weave of the thread, which I did feel in the 22 count hardanger. So 22 count hardanger is technically smaller. This is only 20 count once you do it, you know, one over two. I feel like this is smaller though. That is my sense of how it works, is smaller. And I have not counted this to see how, if it's really 40 count, because I'm not going to, because it's 40. I'm not gonna count to 40 in 1 inch. Even with my magnifier, I don't feel like doing that. Suffice it to say, it's fine. It's working out fine. I can see it well enough. If I did not have the magnifier, I would be lost. So that's nice. I'm enjoying that. It's an interesting first experience with linen. Snippet, Tiger Stare. I want to just call this Tiger Stare because snippet is their designation for the fact that it's a portion of a larger design. So anyway, that's what this is. I'm still trying to make my way down, but I haven't made it very far down, but I did fill in quite a lot with one of the colors of brownish color. So it goes down to about here. So I'm still gonna keep working on trying to make my way down. I'm really tempted to move this way though, because there's a big black section here, which will be extremely easy stitching. But it's not hard, believe me, compared to under the roof of blue Ionian weather, which I'm not gonna show today, it's not that hard because it doesn't have any blended threads. And so it's just simply two over two, well, it's 18 count Aida, so it's two strands over 18 count Aida, and it is, I use the loop start, which just makes it so easy. So I'm not complaining about that at all. I'm not complaining about under the roof of blue Ionian weather either. That is perfectly fine. It's just a little harder. And so last time I think I showed this, this is by 2x2 Stitch Art, and she calls it sampler number 193. This is an Etsy shop. She's a Ukrainian designer, and I ordered a white 16 count Aida, Zweig Art manufacturer, so it's quite nice, and it is definitely even. And I'm going to do that, but I haven't decided what color. It's, you know, just one color. It's monochrome. I think, well, blue. I mean, there's no, you never lose with a beautiful blue. But I did that blue ornament piece last year, which was two shades of blue, and it took quite a while, which is fine. It was beautiful. It's a beautiful set of blues. I think you never miss with red, and there are a lot of reds, and I'll talk in a few minutes about something that I obtained. And frankly, it would be nice in a deep rose or not burgundy exactly, but in that red purple direction. That would be really nice too. And it would be nice in green. I am going to do it in monochrome. I'm going to do it in all one color, one floss. I'm pretty sure I'm going to do it in one floss, because part of the appeal of this is not having to think, now what color shall I make this? Although once you've made a decision, you know, on one quarter of it, at least the whole rest of it is decided. Even so, I'm going to do it in one color. Yeah, I just don't know which color. What do you think? I have a red chair, red and cream colored chair. It could make a cushion for that chair. I have blue, sort of a dark, not navy exactly, but in that direction, blue chair in this room that I normally sit in, family room. What do you think? What do you think? I'd be interested to know what you think. And I would say that purple is a color that I also would be great. It would be wonderful to do it in purple, but I am doing this purple sampler, which I'm about to show you. I'm using mostly Ultimate Sampler Motifs source book by Brenda Keys. This is great. I can't really show you the inside of it because it's, I'll just flip through it. It's just charted things, all charted. There are probably thousands in there, certainly hundreds. So I'm gonna show you how far I've gotten. So here's a new element. This is one of the things I charted myself. When you see it, if you have had any experience in the North Country in northern part of North America, you will recognize it. So I'm gonna show you from the whole thing. You can just scan down until you see the new element. I think it's really cool how that turned out. That is, for those who don't know, or if it's really not as clear as I think it is, that is a loon. And I'm doing canoe paddles. And so I wanna tell a little story. I mean, there are so many stories I could tell about our Canadian vacations. Every lake in the north that's above a certain acreage pretty much has a loon pair, a pair of loons, male and female, and they have one clutch of eggs every year, and they make that nest right on the edge of the lake, and then as soon as the chicks are hatched, they climb up on their parents' backs and they ride around on their backs, which I don't have an image that shows that. Now, when we went camping up there, most of the time we were camping at the beginning of August, and so by that point, the chicks were on their own. That is, they were not on their own. They were still hanging out with their parents, but they were fully fledged and they didn't ride on their parents' backs. They paddled around and dove and fed themselves and that sort of thing. So we didn't see the chicks riding on the parents' backs very much. Never in August. One time we were there in June, which let me just tell you, if you want to go camping in June somewhere in the world, I do not recommend Ontario, Canada, because it is black fly season and it is mosquito season, both at the same time. And if I won't have time, I'm sorry, to find photographs from one particular camping trip that the black flies and mosquitoes were incredible. It was the only time we were up there in June, and we realized that that was a bad idea. We're never doing that again. But let me tell you another time. So we were there in August, and we had pulled up to a boat launch area on the Lake of Two Rivers, which if you follow me on Instagram, you'll see that my nickname on Instagram is Two Rivers. It's because of that lake. So Lake of Two Rivers, it's a pretty large lake. So we pulled up on the boat launch to put our canoes in, and we had another family with us, our friends, Brent and Cindy Clark and their kids, Benjamin and Emma, and our son, who was about 13 or so at the time, probably, and our friend Ann, and my husband and I. So we put our canoes and kayaks and whatever all we had with us in the water, and we paddled over to an island which was not that far. And it was an island that didn't have any buildings on it, and it wasn't part of the campground, it was just an island, but it was frequently visited. And there were some rock shelves next to it so that it was possible to wade in the water, and there might have even been a little beach area, but certainly people would go out there and swim and take their picnic and so on. Well, it was not a large island, but it was large enough. There was a big rocky promontory in the middle. Hump in the middle that you would have to climb over, and so you could not see the other side of the island, and from end to end you couldn't see. There were trees and such. We had been out there, all nine of us, for a while, eight of us, I guess there were, and it was time to go back. Well, I was the one who decided it was time to go back, and so my choice was to yoo-hoo, you know, yoo-hoo, like that, except much louder, to get the attention of our group, which was scattered all around the edges of the island. And I yoo-hooed like that, and I heard a loon call. Well, people didn't respond to my yoo-hoo, so I yoo-hooed again, and the loon called again. There were other people on this island. There were people near me who saw that I was yoo-hooing, and then they heard the loon answer. And so for about 10 minutes, I yoo-hooed and the loon answered. And it would have probably gone on, except by then, finally, our group was together and we got into our vessels and went back across our little flotilla of canoes, etc. But that was just an amazing thing. And so many of my camping experiences up there in Canada have to do with the wildlife up there. So I had to put, upside down. I had to put a loon in there. Another thing that we did a lot was, canoeing is just one of the main things you do, because the campgrounds are on lakes, small lakes, even Lake of Two Rivers. It's a sizable lake, but it's not like Lake Michigan or anything. It's a big enough lake that it's kind of a big lake to canoe across if you're just a novice canoer and you're just out for a jaunt. But there are smaller lakes. Pog Lake, where we normally camped, was a small lake. And there were little rivers that connected the lakes to each other. Lake of Two Rivers has one river out of each end. Huh, wonder why they called it that, I wonder. So we would canoe on the little rivers also. Very, very lovely. Very lovely. And I'll say also, our son, when he was younger, so we started camping there, I think he was maybe six. So clearly, when we had a canoe, we rented a long canoe, a 18-foot canoe or 17-foot canoe, and we had two paddlers, one at each end, and I was usually at the back. And my husband or my friend Ann was usually at the front, except if she was at the back and I was at the front. And then we had two passengers. So it was either my husband and my son or Ann and my son or some combination. But of course, the six-year-old was not really big enough to actually paddle. I mean, we let him try, but in terms of doing a canoe trip, he could not do it. So he rode in the canoe. And he would ride there fairly patiently, except that he wanted to drag his hand in the water, which meant that he had to shift over toward the edge, which meant the canoe was not level. It was like this. It was slanted. And I didn't like that. So the other passenger would shift over to the other side, and then Scott would abruptly decide he was going to shift over to the other side. So then the other, I mean, it was sort of like, it wasn't as if he shifted over every minute, but that other passenger had to be somewhat aware of what Scott was doing because he wanted to trail his hand in the water. Very understandable that a child would want to do that. But when he was about 11 or maybe 10, I said, we're renting him a kayak because it just was, he was also getting bigger and so his weight was more. And so when he shifted over to trail his fingers in the water, it was more so. And also when he put his fingers in the water, his hand in the water, it actually produced a drag. And if we were canoeing into the wind or against the current, his additional drag was actually something that made a difference in the effort required to propel the canoe. So we got him a kayak and he enjoyed that. He liked being somewhat independent, except that he would get tired or claim to get tired. And so we towed him. So I think that the effort of the drag produced by his hand in the water was much less than the drag of actually towing a kayak with a dozing 10-year-old in it. But, you know, we did it. At least our canoe was level because he was not making it tip. It was just really heavy. But canoeing is one of my favorite things. I don't know if physically I could get in and out of a canoe right now, but I sure loved all those years of canoeing. And I never was in a kayak. I have more canoeing stories to tell, which I'll save for some future video. So the only other thing I wanted to talk about today, I'm just looking around my table to be sure I'm not forgetting things. I got one of these. So I don't need this. I don't. Designers need this. But I saw it when I was ordering the fabric for this piece, which I got, by the way, from 123 Stitch, which is a pretty big online cross-stitch shop. I would much rather have gotten it at some local needlework shop, except I don't have one. I do not have one nearby. The closest thing I have is there's a needlepoint shop in Greensboro, which is about an hour from here, which I have never visited. I hear that they have needlepoint silk. That's one of the things they have that, which is something that cross stitchers use and embroidery people use. But they don't have cross stitch stuff very much. So I can't remember the name of it. Then there is, Dying to Stitch up in Norfolk, Virginia, which I visited in February. They have a ton of cross-stitch stuff. They really do. They're quite a small shop in terms of the physical layout of the shop. And when I was there, they didn't have much in the way of Aida. And I know I should use linen. They didn't have much in the way of Lugana either. They didn't have small count. They had some 40 count, a little bit, but they didn't have 46, which I will talk about some other time. And it was a little overwhelming actually to be there because it was so small and they had all of the overdyed threads, which was quite interesting to see because I'd only ever seen pictures of them before. And they had a lot of the silks They had silks there too. But I don't know. I really like DMC and Aida. And Aida, also Aida was pretty hard to come by during the pandemic period, the height of the pandemic, the supply chain issues, getting it from wherever it's made, which Zweigart is made in Germany. Other brands are made other places. And it was just hard to get it. It was hard to come by. So if you saw it, you might buy it, even if you didn't have a plan for it, which made it hard for people who did have a plan and couldn't find it. Anyway, I bought the back to this DMC card. I bought this because it also was not very available for a while. Now it's available. It wasn't really that costly. And all the colors, friends. I showed you that Kona card of fabric. I mean, this goes on and on. Look at that. Isn't that just spectacular? And there are codes up here at the top that tell which colors are available in which type of thread that DMC makes. And so this, the samples are all given in their regular six-strand embroidery floss. And that white line is a little white embroidery floss put between the wraps of the color that they're showing. But then this page shows the things that are not, sorry, this is so awkward, sorry. I don't know if you can see, but see those? Those are the ones that are the variegated or the shiny ones in various forms. And then there's a color code at the top, which you have to have good eyesight to fully discern, that tells which colors are available in which of their other products, which are the pearl cottons. And it's all color-coded, you know, number 116 is this particular type. There's article 116, number 5, number 8, number 12, which has to do with the size of pearl cotton that that is. And it's quite a thorough card. The information, because so the DMC is made in France, but it's sold around the world, and so they have all of the information in probably 20-something languages, which may not be enough, considering how widely sold this is. So when I said that I wasn't sure what color I was going to do that thing, I think I will become sure. Now, of course, I actually own almost a complete set of DMC myself from years ago. Most of it is from years ago. I haven't done too much to add to my set, but there are some beautiful greens in here. And there really are. I could see doing it in green. I would do it in a medium, a green that's bright enough that you can tell that it's green, that it doesn't look like black from a distance, but not light green, probably. So I don't know, we'll see. At first, I was thinking, well, I'm going to start that after I finish Flea Market Flowers, because they're kind of similar effort that it takes to do that kind of stitching. Flea Market Flowers takes a little more effort than this, probably. But then I might not wait, because this coming week is my birthday. Maybe I'll start it on my birthday, or this week as a birthday start. I don't know, that's a tradition, it seems, among cross-stitchers, and I think it's sort of people are egging each other on because of Instagram and YouTube. So I haven't joined into most of those things. You know, there's a sampler September, and there's black stitching in November, and there's mania in May, which means, to some people, it means starting a new project every day of the month of May. So I do not probably own 31 projects that I haven't started. And then I would have 31 projects in progress, which is I think too many. I think it's too many for the people who do that. So I certainly am not going to get on that bandwagon. But the idea of starting a project, a special project, on my birthday is kind of nice. Is this the one I would normally choose? Yeah, I think it's really pretty. I do. I think that's pretty. So, that's that. A couple other things. One other thing going on is, this is the, I know you all you cross-stitch and handwork people are fascinated to know that today is the first day of the World Puzzle Federation Sudoku Grand Prix weekend number 6, round 6, which I'm going to attempt to do that. I probably will do it either this evening or Sunday evening. It goes from, I think the competition opened maybe at noon or 1 o'clock today, and I think it goes through around that same time on Monday. So it's 3 full days. That takes into account that it's a world competition. It truly is. There are, when you look at the results listings, there are, you know, 80 countries represented. And so that allows there to be, everybody's time zones are more than covered. So in the past, I've done it on late at Friday night, you know, starting at 10 o'clock or so. It's a 90-minute timed Sudoku test where you are given maybe 15 puzzles. You have 90 minutes. Each puzzle is worth a certain amount of points based on its approximate difficulty. And if you successfully complete the puzzle and you enter the proof of completion, the code that you need to enter, and it's all done paper and pencil, which is, that makes it quite a bit more challenging than doing it on a computer, because you could, there's no undo key on your paper and pencil. You have to remember the steps you did if you think you've made a mistake in order to back up to try it again. Or you have to have another blank sheet printed out ready to go, which I think that might be what I do tonight, is try to have a blank sheet ready, because I do make mistakes, and sometimes it's faster to start over than it is to try to unwind. But I will do that. My hope is to complete 3 or 4 of the puzzles and get maybe 60 or 70 points. Last month, I completed 3 puzzles, as I thought. I thought I was getting 61 points, I think, but I ended up only getting 24 points because the third puzzle, which was of the ones I attempted, it was the hardest. I apparently didn't do it right, so. And I haven't gone back to check exactly, to redo it and to see if I can get the correct answer. It doesn't really matter because it's in the past. And it's, you can't fix it for the competition. It's just interesting to me. Anyway, that's all. I've been blabbing long enough today. Thank you so much for watching. I hope you found something interesting in my stitching or the other random things I talk about. And I hope you have a great week. Many blessings to you, friends.